Last video ended with the lathe almost ready to run. In just a few minutes we could have the chuck bolted on and start making chips, but in reality that only happened several weeks later. I didn't tell you yet about something that I've been trying to figure out since the day I rebuilt the spindle. If you look closer, on the last video you can see a slim blue box in the background. That's a test bar that I purchased specifically to check the headstock alignment relative to the bedways. And sure enough, the headstock was perfectly aligned, at first, and then it wasn't. I must confess, I spent weeks trying to understand what was happening. And the problem is simple to explain. Every time I removed and inserted the test bar in the taper, I got different readings. And I was counting on having the headstock a little bit off and some run out. What I wasn't expecting was this inconsistency in the readings. So I checked how the headstock sits in the bed and played a little bit with shimming, but that wasn't making any sense to me. Nothing seemed logical and the frustration was building up. After a few weeks I started to think this could only be properly checked by turning some stock. That's when I decided to move on, knowing that maybe, possibly, I would have to take most of the lathe apart again. And as you can see, this issue still happens today, but we'll revisit this on the next video. Meanwhile, if you have an idea of what the problem might be, let me know what you think in the comments below. So I went ahead and rebuilt the apron, the crosslight, the new tool post, and the gearbox, looking forward for that cut. After that, I quickly deburred the change gears just to make sure they went in and out easily, and then moved on to the chuck. Speaking of change gears, I need to go over them again. They have too much play and make too much noise. That's another thing to do. Later. This lathe came with the usual 3-jaw chuck, which in this case is not very accurate and has always given me more than 2000s of run out close to the spindle. That was something that didn't help troubleshooting the spindle issue, as I could not have a source of truth to lead me. I think it was around this time that I saw the 6-jaw on sale. I wasn't looking for a 6-jaw, but it was too cheap to let it pass. I must have paid close to $70 for this chuck. And I'm really glad I got it. After deburring, it came to be a very nice chuck with little run out. Deburring may sound like a quick task, but if you go through the effort of making every edge smooth, it really takes some hours. But it pays off. Having a machine that is smooth to the touch is something that must be experienced. It might seem like it doesn't matter, but it does. Here I'm using a 600 grit diamond coated strip. It just barely cuts, but it's enough to knock off those sharp edges. I'm doing this to make sure all parts register correctly against the machine faces and not against some burrs. And also, I don't want to be cutting my hands when using the lathe. After cleaning all the parts again, I started the reassembly. I used grease on the gears and oil on the scroll and jaws. The reason I didn't use grease on the scroll is because oil allows chips to fall off easier than grease. This is especially helpful after boring something that goes all the way through the chuck jaws. I always get some chips trapped in the scroll and using oil just makes cleaning easier. Before we get to the first chips, let me show you how these 3D printed parts come in handy. These are simple covers for the crosslight T-slots. They prevent chips getting in there, making it easier to clean the lathe. All these parts are printed from PLA, so very hot chips might leave some marks on them. I'm not too concerned about that. This plate helps to prevent chips from getting under the headstock. And this covers the opening for the chuck card switch that I removed. This bracket helps managing the DRO scales cables. Originally, these cables were attached to the bed and always in the way when cleaning. Rerouting them like these, it's like if they don't exist. And finally, my favorite, the compound power fit adapter. And this is it! We got to the much anticipated first cut. 1 year has passed since I purchased the lathe, and around 4 since I bought the other one that I never used. I was both excited and stressing because of the spindle runout readings. And also, this was my very first time using a lathe. Two tens? That doesn't look like much of a taper. This is promising. Let's change to a bigger piece of stock and try the two color method. But for that we'll need the tailstock, so let's clean it first. I have chosen not to paint the tailstock. Not at this point anyway. I guess I just wasn't able to wait any longer to satisfy my curiosity. But before I was able to play, I had some time fiddling with the tailstock alignment. See this part right here? This is what makes the tailstock adjustment possible. It takes one bolt on each side and the adjustment is made by loosening one of the bolts and then tighten the other. That makes the tailstock move towards the bolt being tightened, while the foot stays stationary. The problem is that every time I make an adjustment and retighten the first bolt, the tailstock moves in the opposite way. It's odd, and I definitely need to find a way to center the tailstock quicker. Maybe some sort of registration. I need to think about it. Later. The second problem I had, and I resolved, was the tailstock getting out of alignment after some use. That happened until I realized the slot for the foot was too big, leaving some room for the tailstock to move. A 0.5mm shim on each side was enough to resolve this problem, but again, took me a while to understand why this was happening. I think this is where the rebuild actually ends, because what will follow next is what should always be done when setting up a new machine. Or from time to time, because the machine and the stand, not to mention the floor, will settle. I'm talking about the alignment. Having a lathe properly aligned is crucial to produce good straight parts. So, step one for me, since I can't trust my machine spindle taper, was to turn a soft center in the chuck and align the tailstock with my DTI, using the test bar between centers. My test bar doesn't actually have a good seat for the center, so that's just a rough alignment. I only need this to be good enough to drill the dead center support that I need for roughly machining the two color bar. By the way, I'm not covering how to make this bar. There's a lot of good videos out there about that. The main goal here is to turn a long piece of stock with no tailstock support, until we get both ends the same size, or within our desired tolerance. As you can see, There's almost 2,000 difference over 6 inches. That means the machine is producing a taper. In order to fix that, and by fixing I mean making the machine produce a straight part, an adjustment needs to be done. In a benchtop lathe like this, that adjustment is made by adding or removing shims under the feet of the lathe. Let me show you what's happening. This is a perfect scaled model of my lathe. The cutter is almost touching the brass bar in the chuck, but if we remove the shim under the feet, it will move back. And that's exactly the case. The further the carriage moves away from the chuck, the closer the cutter gets to the work, and therefore a tapered cut is evidenced in the long part being cut. So the first thing to do is to remove the shim on the headstock side. That's only making things worse. Then try a few test cuts with different shims on the tailstock side, only at the front. Eventually, I settled with a quarter of a millimeter worth of shims. This process is, in fact, a refinement of the leveling done previously. Being able to make a straight cut means that the test bar runout issue is either the spindle taper or the test bar itself. But anyway, now that we have the basic alignment done, the tailstock needs to be readjusted once again. So here I am using the same method as before to make that first rough alignment. And for that I'm considering that the test bar is actually straight. Which should be, since the specification says it was ground to the highest industrial standards. So, after this initial alignment, I started to make some cuts with the tailstock support and adjusting it as needed. In the end, I settled with a difference of 6 tenths over 9 inches. Finally, the last piece of the puzzle. Let's look at the thread dial indicator. This lathe came with this thread dial from the factory, but I can't understand how they ship something like this. Allow me to show you the problem. Did you see what happened? That's right, as the lead screw rotates, eventually the keyway will align with the end of the dial gear. And in that moment, that gear disengages from the lead screw. Problem? A big clunk when it tries to engage again. And I was lucky not to break the lead screw or the dial. Luckily now I have a lathe, so I can make a new shaft with a spacer to fix this, basically keeping the dial engaged at all times. And this was the first part I ever made on my lathe, or in fact, in any lathe. I hope you liked this rebuild series. I tried to keep it short and condensed for the sake of your time. So I hope you got some valuable information out of this, or at least found this series entertaining. It was 1 year of hard work, although I didn't do much for a few months, but I enjoyed every little bit. And I think it paid off. I may have lost warranty on day one, but I trust I won much more by feeling very comfortable around the lathe. But, as you can tell by now, I'm just starting in the machining world, and I'm taking my time trying to make things right. So, I appreciate every constructive comment I receive. This is a good moment to tell you that I wasn't counting on making YouTube videos when I started with the lathe rebuild. But now I am. And if you're curious about this channel's roadmap, what I can tell is that I have some interesting projects coming up. I might be making a tool or two in the next videos because I need them, but I don't want to get caught in that tool to make a tool circle. Having a regular posting schedule will be hard for now, although I'm trying to aim for a video per month. Editing really takes time and a good chunk is for recording the voiceover, which has been, hands down, my main challenge. I just hope you're able to understand most of what I say. But, having said that, I've already made some progress editing the next video, and I'm expecting to release it in just a couple of weeks. Until then, and if any of this resonates with you, please consider subscribing. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you on the next one.